Det er jo sådan, at den 5. september hvert år, der er det der hedder Veteranernes Dag i Danmark. Det er jo ikke 5. september i dag, men det arrangement, vi har fået stablet på banen her sammen med FC Nordsjælland, det har sit udspring i Veteranernes Dag. Og det er jo sådan, at hvis ikke I ved det, så har Danmark jo faktisk helt tilbage fra 2002, det var faktisk før I blev født, der var Danmark jo, blev Danmark engageret i krigen i Afghanistan, eller var med til sammen med de allierede at gå ind i Afghanistan. Og siden dengang, så har jeg tror over 10.000 unge mænd og kvinder været engageret fra Danmark i projektet i Afghanistan. Og det handlede om at skabe stabilitet og sikkerhed. Og som I forhåbentlig opdagede sådan hen over sommerferien, så skete der jo noget i forhold til det engagement. Det var sådan, at Danmark sammen med de andre allierede kom temmelig hovedkuls ud af det engagement. Og i den mellemliggende periode er det jo sådan, at Taliban har overtaget magten, og det har jo fået rigtig stor betydning for befolkningen i Afghanistan, og ikke mindst for pigerne og for kvinderne. Og derfor er det jo sådan, at i dag er der nok rigtig mange, der spørger sig selv om, var det indsatsen værd, at vi brugte så mange ressourcer og sendte så mange unge mennesker afsted til den indsats i Afghanistan? Det er jo et stort spørgsmål, og det er også et spørgsmål, som er rigtig svært at svare på. Jeg tror heller ikke, der gives nogen entydige sort-hvide svar på det spørgsmål. Og derfor er det en rigtig stor glæde, at vi kan byde velkommen til to gæster, to specielle gæster, som har en helt særlig indsigt i det spørgsmål. Og de to, jeg gerne vil byde velkommen til, de er forskellige. De har det til fælles i øjeblikket, at de er på forskellige vis engageret i FC Nordsjælland. Og det er Philip May, som sidder her, og som er fanambassadør for FC Nordsjælland.
Okay.
Det har jeg hørt i hvert fald.
Ja, ja, den tager jeg gerne.
Arbejdet er lidt skævt her.
Ja, nej, det er fedt.
Men velkommen til Philip.
Tak.
Udover det med at arbejde med fans, så har blevet Philip allerede en alder af 20 år udsendt som soldat til Afghanistan. I er jo ikke 20 år endnu, men næsten jeres alder, så ung var Philip, da han blev sendt til Afghanistan. Og så ved siden af Philip, der sidder Kalita Popal, som er født i Afghanistan, og som oplevede helt tilbage i 96, hvordan Taliban overtog magten, og oplevede, hvad det kom til at betyde for hende, men også efterfølgende, hvad det betød, at Danmark og andre lande sendte soldater til Afghanistan, hvilken indflydelse det havde på hendes og hendes families liv. Så de to unge mennesker, vi har her, de vil tematisere det, de vil fortælle det ud fra deres perspektiv. Hvad er det, de har oplevet, og hvordan ser de situationen? Var det indsatsen værd, eller var det ikke indsatsen værd? Og for at lede os igennem det, så har vi Christian Volny, som sidder her ved siden af. Han er facilitator på det, vi skal have nu. Og det vil også være sådan, at I skal ikke bare sidde og være passive tilskuere her, men I vil også blive involveret i dialogen. Så jeg synes, at vi skal byde dem rigtig hjertelig velkommen ved at give dem en hånd. Og så må I bare engagere jer rigtig meget i snakken. Velkommen.
Tak for det, Carsten, og tak fordi I måtte komme. Har vi glædet os meget til. Følger os unge igen tilbage i skolen. Som Carsten fik nævnt, det her det handler om noget, der hedder Veteranernes Dag. I virkeligheden er det en kampagne, der er sat i gang af Danmarks Idrætsforbund, som skal sætte fokus på, hvordan at krigsveteraner bliver reintegreret, hedder det, Philip, i samfundet igen, når man kommer hjem fra krig. Hvilken hjælp skal de have, fordi der er brug for hjælp, og det er det, man prøver at sætte fokus på. Superliga-klubberne med i det denne gang, bliver markeret til næste spillerunde. Det er vi selvfølgelig også. I FC Nordsjælland har vi det sådan, at når vi går ind i noget, så vil vi også gerne vide noget om det. Vi vil gerne uddanne os selv, inden vi begynder at fortælle andre om det. Og derfor er vi her for at uddanne os selv, sammen med jer. Det kan også være, at I måske bliver en lille smule klogere hen ad vejen. Men vi er så heldige, at vi har nogle mennesker hos os, som faktisk kan hjælpe os med det her. Og som kan dele nogle ting. Det vil vi prøve på. Men først skal jeg lige, det er mange år siden, jeg går i skole. Dengang, der rakte man fingeren op, når man havde noget at sige. Gør I stadig det? Der er ikke en app til den slags nu. Nej. Prøv lige at række fingrene op alle sammen. Det virker. Glimrende. Yes. Vi skal snakke om Afghanistan. Vi skal snakke om det at være i krig. Vi skal snakke om hvorfor. Og måske endda nå frem til nogle svar. Først bare lige for at teste det med at række fingrene op og se, hvad I kan. Hvad ved I, ud over den korte instruktion, som Carsten lige gav, hvad ved I om det, der er sket i Afghanistan? Det med fingrene gik bedre før. Hvad ved du i en landsholdstrøje dernede? Ja, det er der, jeg kigger på nu. Hvad ved du om, hvad der sker lige nu i Afghanistan? Ja. Lad os se, om vi kan få det. Vi kan få aktivitetsniveauet lidt op senere hen. Taliban, danske soldater i krig, menneskerettigheder. Der er mange ting, som det her berører. Men i bund og grund er der et spørgsmål, som ofte vender tilbage i den debat, der er lige nu, omkring de danske soldater, der blev trukket ud af Afghanistan efter 20 år. Var det det værd? Var det det værd? Der er nogen, der er døde. Der er nogen, der har ar på sjælen. Der er nogen, der mangler arme eller ben. Var det det værd? Hvad kom der ud af det? For når man ser nyhederne nu, så er det sådan lidt, men er det ikke bare tilbage til, hvad det var? Det kan vi måske blive klogere på. Men det er helt store spørgsmål. Og nu skal jeg nok lade være med at kigge på dig. Fordi nu kigger jeg på dig. Og siger, hvad skal der til, før man er villig til at ofre sit liv for noget? Det skal være en god sag. Hvad er en god sag? Hvis man mener selv, hvad mener du er godt? Nok til, at du vil ofre dit liv, eller i hvert fald risikere dit liv for det? For fædrelandet? Ja, okay. Interessant. Hvad siger du? Du har faktisk fingeren op. Det virker. Ofre sit liv for at redde andre. Ja.
Det handler også om, at man kæmper for nogle værdier, som man selv står for, og man ønsker, at nogle andre mennesker også kunne gøre det, de værdier, kan man sige.
Hvilke værdier er det for dig?
Det er sådan noget som frihed, ytringsfrihed, demokrati, ligestilling osv.
Hørte I det altså? Godt. Glemmer det. Lad os lige få introduceret kort, hvem det er, vi har med. Carsten gjorde det også. Jeg sætter nogle flere ord på. Philip May, de fleste kender ham nok som reality personality. Det har Philip også været. Men Philip har også været i krig i flere måneder. 7 måneder, tror jeg, vi regner os frem til. Og da Philip kom hjem, så fandt han ud af, at det er ikke så let, når man har oplevet noget, som dem, man kommer hjem til, ikke har oplevet. Og Philip er i dag ansat i et hjem for autistramte børn, som du tager dig godt af. Er det i Slagelse?
Mm.
Ja, stærkt. Khalida er fra Afghanistan, anfører for det første kvindelandshold overhovedet i fodbold i Afghanistan. Fik arrangeret, også at Afghanistan kom ind i FIFA som et medlem der for kvindefodbold. Og endte med til sidst om at forlade Afghanistan, og det skal Khalida selvfølgelig nok fortælle mere om. Hvor mange herinde kender, hvem skal vi tage? Hvor mange kender Messi? Det gør alle. Hvor mange kender Cristiano Ronaldo? Okay. Hvor mange kender Sepp Blatter? Der er nogen, der gør. Det er magtfulde mænd i fodbold, vi snakker om nu. Men det, jeg lige vil sige om Khalida, det er, at hun blev sidste år kåret til at være en af de 50 mest indflydelsesrige mennesker i hele verden inden for fodbold. Så ved I det. Så det er ikke helt ligegyldigt, det hun har lavet. Men Khalida kommer til at snakke på engelsk. Det er der ikke nogen her, der har et problem med, vel? Støjle sig med engelsk. Klimerne. Så bliver det lidt af det hele. Godt. Jeg tænkte på, om ikke vi skal starte med at se noget video. Det plejer vi at være gode til.
Taliban er en ultrakonservativ politisk og religiøs bevægelse. I 1996 tillader Taliban at terrornetværket.
Tak til Danmarks Radio for lige at hjælpe os med at blive klogere på kort tid. Så slap vi for at gøre det. Vi kommer til at snakke om det her. Hele den her tidslinje, der lige er blevet lukket op her. Et godt sted at starte, tænker jeg kunne være, Khalida, if you could tell us how it was in Afghanistan when this video started in 1996, before USA and the rest of the world started focusing on it, how was life in Afghanistan before this?
First of all, I apologize for speaking in English and not your language. In a very beautiful, romantic day, I have difficult time to speak in Danish. Today is a very emotional day for me. It is about my girls, it's about my country. So it is very emotional. Watching the video, it reminds me the time when the Taliban took over Afghanistan, where I lost the opportunity to study, where they announced the girls and women cannot study, cannot work, will have no right to participate in society actively. And they took everything from us. They vanished half of the population, which is women and girls, from the country. We were not allowed to go to school, to work, even getting out without having a man with us was difficult. The women could not be independent. So many women and girls were forced to get married with Taliban and their allies. So many women lost the opportunities. There were many suicide attacks. And many women lost the opportunity and the freedom. We had no voice, and all the voices were taken, and women were. They were victim. They were victim of a war. They were victim of a decision. They were victim of the people. The women had no choices. They had no voice in the situation, but they were victim. The stadium, football stadium, were used for public execution. You see the women there on the penalty or the box area, where her fault was that she said no to getting married. And that's why. I remember exactly the same picture out there when I was young. I was 9 years old, and I was going in a city with my grandmother, where she was wearing burqa. And the Taliban came, and everybody was scared. And they had the leash in their hand, and they were beating women. And my grandmother and mother was one of them that were beaten, without any reason. They didn't want women to be visible at all. When we lost the opportunity of education, we were forced to leave the country, because my mom and dad was very active. My mom was an activist, was a school teacher, but also my dad was in government. I lost my childhood in this war, went to Pakistan forced as a refugee, and entered in a labor market. I started working together with my father and the rest of the family members. And my job was making the breaks to participate equally with my father and my grandfather to manage to get food and survive. Beside that, of course, I was studying in a refugee camp in Pakistan until everything changed and we had to go back to our country. The hope and in international allies were coming to our country. Everything was happy news around, and I remember my dad was jumping up and down, my grandfather, because we were looking so much forward to go back to our country, to go back to our home. And it was NATO soldiers, the soldiers from around the world came to help us, to help the women and girls to get the right education, to go to school and actively participate. You see this photo, it's actually from 2011, but this is the NATO or ISAF compound where we've trained. And they say that the helicopters there, we were protected and safe. And we had this protection from soldiers who are in our country. We had the opportunity to play football. For me, playing football, the only thing I knew was playing football, because I grew up with my brothers, and the only game, the only activity we had that time was football. I was playing street football. And returning back home, where the war took everything and brainwashed the generation, it was very difficult for women to come and be visible in the society. And there was still fear of Taliban returning back. I took the ball and I said I will take the ball where that bring like help me to feel freedom. Football helped me to feel happy, to feel freedom, to not think about the challenges that I was facing. And I wanted to bring in the culture to help more women and girls in my age to feel the freedom. I brought football into school. We started playing football. We had the support from great friends who came to support and protect us in our country. We really fought hard and took football as a tool to empowerment, but also inclusion of women and girls in our country. And we started campaigns to stand together and bring the visibility to also show the Taliban and whoever was supporting the Taliban ideology that women and girls are strong and we are half of the population. And this is the new generation, the generation of hope. We started playing football. We managed to get our many girls in our team. We started the league in Afghanistan, and then afterwards, our first women's national team. This is the photo of the very first women's national team. And it's 2007, and it's not long from when we lost our first time, the right to be part of the society. We were very, very proud to represent our country. And there is a video, it shows where we played against the NATO soldiers, the women and the female NATO soldiers that was in our country. It was for a peace game, we called, because we wanted to invite the soldiers who are fighting for us to protect us. We wanted to introduce them, to be introduced with them. We wanted to tell them that we are here, we are thankful for all your fight and support. We are here. And we are happy that you're protecting and saving us. So this is a game, an example of the game that we played with them. Can you play that? I'm a little bit nervous.
These girls are an inspiration to me.
Afghanistan number one!
It's good for us because the thing what we need is media to aware the people that we Afghanistan have team and they can play football. The women can play football in Afghanistan, so that is good. And the first thing which is very important for us that we are going to do friendly match with armies, and we want to show the armies that we some of our people. Are bad, they are fighting, but the others are, they want to be friends and they want to be to peace in Afghanistan.
In this very courageous match, it's wonderful to watch. They've played very strong, and the thing we have to all remember is that just a few years ago, this would not have been possible. The Taliban would not have allowed it. But the Afghans want freedom, they're going to do the best they can, and they're out there proving it today.
I'm very excited. Just it's an honor to be able to play, and these girls are an inspiration to me, I can tell you, because they've been fighting for so long, and that's amazing. So, way to go, Afghanistan.
It's very heartwarming, really, to see them out here playing, you know, when they face so much oppression. To be able to just play a game of soccer is so heartwarming.
Good job. You did great. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot.
Thank
you.
Thanks. We are very, very proud of your performance today. And all we hope for is that this is just the beginning. So yes. Next year, 5 years from now, your grandchildren, it just gets better and better.
Yes. Tak, Kalita, for at dele det. Når nogen af jer får lyst til at spørge om et eller andet, så tank det op. Vi skal nok nå til det sidst. I får lov at stille alle de spørgsmål, I vil. Og der er ikke noget, man ikke må spørge om. Så Husk det lige, og så vender vi tilbage til det, så er det bare op med fingeren, når vi når dertil. Philip, nu har Kalita beskrevet, hvordan livet var inden, og også hvad det gjorde for hendes familie og hendes samfund, at soldaterne kom. Da beslutningen blev taget om, at Danmark skal være med i den her FN-koalition, som skal gribe ind i Afghanistan, der går jeg ud fra, at du er soldat i Danmark, som så mange andre. Og lige pludselig, eller hvordan finder man egentlig ud af, at nu skal vi i krig, og du skal med?
Jamen altså, lige når det... det er tonet lidt højere her. Altså, jeg er ikke decideret soldat lige på det tidspunkt. De danske tropper, de begynder at gå ind i Afghanistan. Men jeg har en idé om, at jeg gerne vil være soldat. Ikke en idé om, at jeg vil udsendes på et tidspunkt. Jeg var 19 år og havde prøvet nogle ungdomsuddannelser, og jeg havde sgu lidt for meget krudt i røven. Så jeg kom aldrig videre med noget som helst. Så tænkte jeg, hvor kan jeg få det sociale? Hvor kan jeg få noget disciplin? Jeg tager sgu i militæret. Så jeg kom på forsvaret og tog værnepligten. Jo længere jeg var derinde i værnepligten, jo bedre kunne jeg lide den her idé med at være soldat. Da vi var nogle foredrag, og vi blev vist, at man kunne blive udsendt til Afghanistan. Og jeg har selvfølgelig også fulgt med i medierne. Og jeg vil rigtig gerne gøre en forskel på en eller anden måde. Jeg kunne gøre en forskel. Så derfor valgte jeg simpelthen at tage i krig. Tage den uddannelse, hvor man har muligheden for at komme til Afghanistan. Og det kan man allerede dengang. Efter 12 måneder, så bliver man udsendt. Så det var sådan min historie, før Afghanistan så ud. Det kan lige vise der. Det er jo ikke det Afghanistan, jeg nogensinde har set. Jeg var et helt andet sted. Jeg var i Helmand. Jeg var kamptrop, så jeg var ude for at skubbe Talibans linjer væk, så de ikke kunne komme ind i de store byer, kan man sige. Ikke? Så det rører mig meget at se det der, faktisk, jeg lige har set. For det har jeg slet ikke oplevet. Det vil jeg bare lige sige. Nu skal vi lige tilbage til, hvorfor. Det er faktisk historien med, hvordan jeg blev hvordan jeg kom til at blive udsendt. Det gjorde jeg, fordi jeg ville gøre en forskel. Om det var, hvad jeg havde regnet med, og hvad jeg skulle ned til, og hvad det har gjort efterfølgende, det tror jeg aldrig, man kan sætte sig op til på nogen som helst måde. Det er jo noget, der sidder i mig den dag i dag, og det er noget, der sidder i mig hver dag, og det er noget, jeg tænker over hver eneste dag. Hvad der er sket dernede, men det tænker jeg, vi kommer lidt ind på senere hen. Ja, det kan lukke den her, indtil vi kommer lidt videre.
Du siger, at du er egentlig afklaret med, at du gerne vil i krig. Altså, at det var den uddannelse, du tog.
Ja.
Nu spurgte jeg de unge mennesker her, hvad skal der til, for at man sætter sit liv på spil? For det ved du jo godt, du gør, eller hvad, da du siger ja. Altså, er det med det i tanken, at du kan risikere at miste dit liv på det her?
Jeg tror, det er nemt at sidde her og sige, at man er klar til at miste sit liv, for før man står i varmen og virkelig, virkelig når patronerne flyver om dit hoved, der finder du ud af, om du er klar til at miste dit liv. Det er kammeratskabet, det er alt, man bygger op sammen i militæret, som også gjorde noget for mig. Jeg oplevede 5 uger før vi skulle afsted til Afghanistan, der oplevede jeg allerede død på den nærmeste måde, eller tættest på mig. Jeg var med i et motoruheld over i Oksbøl, hvor jeg mistede 2 af mine kammerater 5 uger før vi skulle afsted. I det rør, jeg skulle ned og arbejde med, som I kan se der, det er en morter, jeg skyder med. Den sprang i luften under en øvelse, og 2 af mine kammerater døde. Og jeg var 5 meter derfra. Så allerede der kom døden rigtig tæt på, og jeg skulle allerede sådan revurdere, om jeg overhovedet ville til Afghanistan og opleve noget, der kunne være lignende det her. Den her sorg, jeg oplevede, og finde ud af, at det er sgu rigtig våben, vi skyder med. For du kan rende rundt til træning og alle de øvelser, vi har, så kan du skyde med løbspatroner, så kan du finder aldrig ud af, hvad det virkelig er. Det finder du først ud af, når du står dernede. Den stress, der rammer dig. Så allerede der skulle jeg revurdere, om jeg overhovedet skulle i krig. Og det er også noget af det, der kommer senere, at det er meget, meget er formet af det uheldige Oksbøl, som er så gået senere hen og har givet mig diagnosen PTSD med de oplevelser, jeg har haft i Afghanistan. Det er mange ting, der spiller ind rigtig hurtigt, som... Nu tabte jeg sgu lige tråden, voldeligt. Hvor fanden kom vi fra?
Vi snakker om det her med at være villig til og være klar over, at man risikerer noget.
Ja.
Når man siger ja til det her.
Jeg tror, altså, Man får den kastet hårdt ned på en, fordi man skal allerede skrive sit testamente, før man skal afsted, noget der hedder sin sidste vilje. Så der skriver man allerede et farvelbrev, før man tager i krig til sin familie og sine venner, og hvordan man vil begraves, og hvad man vil høre i kirken. Allerede der skal man tage stilling til alle de her ting. Og der er mange, der ikke tager det seriøst, fordi det bliver aldrig dem, man tænker altid over. Man tænker altid over, at det ikke er en selv, det går ud over. Men det ender sgu altid med, at det rammer en på en eller anden måde. Ikke lige døden, men døden kan også sådan påvirke dig. Selvom døden rammer andre, kan den også godt påvirke dig på en endnu hårdere måde, for du skal leve med det.
43 soldater kom ikke hjem.
Ja.
Og af dem har der jo været, hvor mange er man i en gruppe afsted?
Ja, vi var et kompagni afsted på 150 mand. Mm.
Så alle tager det jo med hjem på en eller anden måde og påvirker det her, når man oplever det.
Du kan ikke undgå at blive påvirket. Det er jo alle, du kender alle på en eller anden måde, alle dine kammerater. Nogle er selvfølgelig tættere end andre. Og tit så er det jo pisse uretfærdigt, at det lige skal gå ud over dem. Men altså, det er jo krig, og det lærer man på den hårde måde, så snart man lander. Så altså første dag, jeg var dernede, der var vi allerede under beskydning i den lejr, jeg var, ikke? Og der havde jeg allerede skudt med mit våben allerede første dag, jeg var der, i den lejr, vi skulle være i. Og det blev ved de næste 2-3 måneder, der var vi under beskydning. Hver anden dag til hver dag, ikke? Der lærer du på en hård måde. Du går nærmest i sådan en trance af overlevelse. Og det er jo den high arousal, du har der, det stressniveau, du har. Det er jo det, du har svært ved at give slip på, når du kommer hjem på en eller anden måde. Det du ikke kan give slip på, det sidder så meget i dig. Det sikkerhed, du hele tiden skal have, at du tænker ikke så meget over, at du kan miste livet dernede. Du tænker rigtig meget over det, lige når du lander. Og du tænker rigtig meget over det, lige før du skal hjem. I midten, der er det bare ren overlevelse.
Men når man er i det, under beskydning og i det her overlevelsesmode, ja. Husker man så, hvorfor man er der? Husker du, hvorfor du tog afsted? Husker du, hvem du er der for? Hvad det er, du kæmper for?
Nej. Det synes jeg ikke, tiden var til det. Jeg var i en boble af de her patrol baseline i Helmand, hvor jeg havde en opgave, jeg skulle klare. Jeg ville ønske, jeg kunne tænke tilbage til, hvorfor jeg var der. Det var tiden. Altså, det følte bare ikke, tiden var til. Det gik bare på sådan et hjul hele tiden, hvor vi bare skulle klare den her opgave. Vi skulle skubbe Taliban væk, vi skulle være sikkerhedsstyrker, vi skulle lave hearts and minds. De civile skulle have det godt i det område, vi var. Og det var primært opgaven for os, at de civile skulle have det godt. Så det store billede var svært at finde frem. Og du kan ikke undgå at blive vred, når en af dine kammerater dør. Du kan ikke undgå at blive mere sur. Det er svært at huske det store billede, når man mister en, man har nært. Så bliver man sur. Og hvem skal du gå ud over? Skal du gå ud over dine venner, eller bliver man endnu mere sur på Taliban, som har været skyldig der, som bliver ved med at prøve at slå dig ihjel? Så det bliver et eller andet... det bliver et eller andet hadeforhold på en eller anden måde, hvor det er rigtig svært at agere i.
Khalida, what does it make you feel and think when you hear Philip talk about this?
I really want to thank Philip, because you put your heart, your mind, your life, your future to protect us. I'm sitting here just so I can face you on behalf of all my girls, all the women of Afghanistan who felt the freedom, who got the chance to
to live the life, even it was very short time. It's because of you and all the young people and all the people who fought for us so we can feel the life, understand for right to understand we are human and we are not animals as Taliban or the people like Taliban call us, the women of Afghanistan. We feel that we are human. We got the right to have education, to have the voice. Stand for other sisters. When I started playing football, it was another fight. We took the ball to fight, and that was the only tool we had. And we were standing for the rest of the women who lost their lives under the Taliban, who are forced to get married with the Taliban, with the imams that didn't want to live their life. They were in prison. And we started with just having four girls playing football and understanding what is life, what is freedom mean, till the 2 months ago, when Taliban took over the country, we were more than 4,000, 5,000 women and girls who are registered playing football, who represented the country, who felt the freedom. And today they are standing. The only picture in Afghanistan you see today is the women standing against Taliban, having their voices and fighting Taliban. And that is what you have done to us and you have given. And I am thankful for you, for all your friends who lost their life, because it was worth it, because you have given us the chance, the voice that was taken from us. So thank you so much, and thank you. Thanks to all your friends who gave a lot of sacrifices. Thank you. I'll sit back there. And I'm sorry for becoming very emotional. It's first time. I used to be very strong. I mean, this is strong. It's like when you cry, sit and be very emotional, it is also the sign of being strong and being honest.
Khalida, can you describe to us how you said you came back to Afghanistan when the soldiers came? Can you describe how life changed in a in the period where soldiers were there?
My mom, grandmother, and all the other women went back to work. They got the freedom to be independent women. They had the earnings, they had the self-confidence to participate actively in the society. They got their voices back. The women and girls started going back to school. The girls' schools opened. Many women and girls went to school. Many events and activities took place where women were actively participating. So it was sports, education, art, music. The women and girls were more visible and strong and represented our country in an international level. We have had singers, musicians, like young girls who are participating, getting different scholarships, sports people representing our country in Olympics. So there are many positive things happened. And the picture of Afghanistan changed. We introduced the generation, the new generation of Afghanistan to the world that we don't want fight, we don't want war, we want peace and freedom. And that is what the world saw.
So what do you see today? Because it was decided about 5 years ago that at some point the soldiers should come home. And as we heard, President Trump said, now it's going to happen. And when USAID went home, Denmark went home, everyone went home. What do you see today in Afghanistan?
Unfortunately, the country collapsed again. the government of Afghanistan surrendered. The Taliban took back the country, took the full power. The announcement is made that the girls should not go to school anymore. The Taliban don't see sports as something necessary for women and girls. There will be Sharia law in the country where the Taliban want the people to follow. The Islamic State took over the country where they say women and girls should not be part of the society or equal part in the society. Women and girls are back in their some sort of prison at home. They lost all their basic human rights. What the positive thing is happening, that this time, which is very different than 1996 when Taliban took over the full control of Afghanistan, this time the women and girls, they are standing and fighting for their right. They are standing in the streets, they are demonstrating, not only in Afghanistan but around the world, for their right to be part of the society, to their right to have education, their right to have active participation in the country. And this is something that I feel very proud. Every time I see that picture, I feel very proud, because the women and girls have this, the power, got this power. They're fighting. We know that even like maybe we will not win this, but at least we have raised our voices and we stood up. And that's the most beautiful thing that we can see. And I'm hoping the generation, the new generation, will not accept this, because they have felt the freedom. They have understood what is it, the power of education, power of freedom. And I'm hoping that they will not accept the barbaric governing bodies like Taliban or whatever. Religious people. They're using religion as a means or as an excuse to take over the power. But I'm very happy that the new generation is really fighting hard, and I'm hoping that it will change.
Philip, da du kommer hjem fra Afghanistan, hvad oplever du? Hvad oplever du så?
Da jeg kom hjem fra Afghanistan, jamen altså, det korte svar er jo, at jeg er ikke den samme overhovedet. Jeg har været 7 måneder i krig. Jeg har mistet 5 af mine kammerater på under 1,5 år. Jeg har set ting, jeg aldrig troede, jeg skulle se i mit liv. Jeg har kæmpet for overlevelse. Jeg har levet uden noget som helst, uden internet, skidt i en pose, levet altså helt nede, hvor vi slet ikke havde noget. Ikke? Efterreaktionerne, de var der med det samme. Og jeg kunne ikke erkende det overhovedet. Jeg var Superman. Jeg var ung. Det går ikke ud over mig, det her. Det går over sig selv. Så hvad gør jeg? Jeg begynder at finde ud af, hvordan jeg sådan kan selvregulere mine følelser på den bedste måde. Altså finde ud af, hvordan jeg kan overleve det her, ligesom jeg har prøvet at overleve alt andet. Jeg begynder at drikke rigtig meget. Jeg begynder at tage stoffer. Jeg begynder at gøre alt for at skubbe de her tanker væk. Det hjælper. Det gør det bare endnu værre, når jeg vågner op fra det hver gang. Jeg begynder at få mareridt om natten. Jeg begynder at få flashbacks. Jeg begynder at blive påvirket af lugte, af lyde. Mit det der high arousal, der snakkede om, mit sådan sikkerhed, at min stress, den kan ikke lægge sig. Jeg kan simpelthen ikke få det væk. Lige meget hvad jeg gør. Jeg har det som om, der hele tiden sker et eller andet. der kommer til at ske det værste hele tiden. Hvis jeg kigger rundt om et hjørne, så kommer der til at være en eksplosion. Der kommer til at blive påvirket et eller andet. Jeg overlever. Altså, det er ikke fordi, at jeg ikke kan... Altså, som nogen af jer nok har set, så kan jeg jo godt fungere i mange ting. Jeg er jo stadig en glad dreng, og nogle folk vil kalde mig jubeloptimist, og det er jo nok derfor, jeg er kommet så langt den dag i dag. Men jeg begynder også at påvirke de mennesker rundt om mig. Jeg kan ikke åbne mig over for nogen som helst. Der er ikke nogen, der kan forstå mig. Der er ikke nogen, der kan forstå mig, fordi jeg har været i krig, og de kan slet ikke forstå, hvad der er. De skal slet ikke komme ind på mig, for det så eksploderer. Jeg har ikke selv snakket om det, så hvordan fanden skal jeg kunne snakke med det om nogen andre? Jeg prøver bare at gemme det væk. Jeg prøver bare at undgå det her, fordi hvad nu hvis den her ballon eksploderer? Hvad sker der? Så får jeg en psykose. Hvad sker der? Det er de tanker, jeg hele tiden går med. Jeg er så pisse bange. Jeg vælger så at tage til en psykolog. Og sige, at jeg ikke har det godt. Og det gør jeg først... Det gør jeg først... 6-7 år senere, 8 år senere måske.
Hvor mange af dine kammerater fra krigen, som kommer hjem, oplever nogenlunde det samme? Det samme mønster, de samme ting, de samme mangler, de samme behov?
Altså, nu kan jeg jo ikke snakke om det. Altså, det store billede, det har jeg ikke sådan helt styr på. Men det er der mange, der gør. Altså, jeg kan ikke sige, hvor mange... Der er en stor del i den her PTSD, det er noget, en af de her hovedelementer i det, noget der hedder undgåelse. Du undgår alt, der minder dig om de her situationer, du har været i. Og det er soldaterkammerater også en del af det her. Så du prøver at undgå at gå ind i det, prøver at undgå den her samtale. Så et eller andet sted skubber du også dem væk. Du skubber alt væk, der kommer for tæt på. Og det gør soldaterkammerater også. På en eller anden måde. Med mindre nu, der er det nemt for mig at række ud, fordi jeg har bearbejdet alle de her ting, men det er svært for dem at række ud, fordi de ikke har. Så der er rigtig, jeg tror ikke på, at man ikke kan komme hjem, hvis man har været i som kamptrop i en kampsituation. Du kan ikke komme hjem uden en eller anden form for efterreaktion. Selvom den er mild eller høj, så sker der et eller andet med psyken i sådan nogle situationer, når du er under massivt stress.
Det kan Lita dele før, og det som hun fortalte også. Hvor meget betyder det, når man sidder i dit sted og måske har brug for at høre, at der var sgu en god grund til det her?
Sindssygt meget. Helt vildt. Taknemmelig. Som jeg også fortalte før, så er det store billede, kan lige det fortælle, det er det, jeg aldrig så. Det eneste, jeg så, det var kamp og overlevelse. Jeg så ikke, hvad det arbejde, vi gjorde andre steder. Så jeg har ingen idé om, hvad jeg gjorde. Og når man sidder herhjemme lige pludselig og hører alt det der med, har der været spildt og sådan noget, jamen så tror man det lige pludselig, at det har det. Du reflekterer i hvert fald over det, fordi du aldrig har hørt en historie som Kalitas før. Du ved ikke rigtigt, hvad har det egentlig gjort, alt det vi gjorde hver dag. Så jeg er super taknemmelig. Jeg er også pisse ydmyg. Det er svært for mig at sidde og få så meget kærlighed, når jeg bare føler mig som en lille soldat, der bare gjorde mit arbejde, ikke? Så jeg er super taknemmelig. Jeg vil da ønske alle mine kammerater kunne høre det.
Debatten herhjemme, og det kan være nogen, jeg også har fulgt med det, omkring den tilbagetrækning, har jo netop været, var det det værd? Altså når vi alligevel tog hjem efter 20 år, hvorfor tog vi så overhovedet derned? Der var også nogen, der døde, så kunne vi lige så godt lade være, når alligevel vi tog hjem til sidst, og så kom Taliban tilbage.
Ja.
Du siger, at det fik dig faktisk til at få det dårligt at høre den debat og høre den tone i det, eller hvordan?
Alt fik det til at vende sig i mig, da jeg så alle de der ting i medierne. For det første, så er det, jeg har jo været nede og kæmpe for en kors, og for folk skulle have det bedre. Og, altså, det har jeg jo, og så lige pludselig, som om alt bare blev smidt væk fra den ene dag til den anden. Det gjorde rigtig ondt inde i mig. Og så få at vide, at det har været spildt. Altså, jeg har mistet kammerater dernede. Jeg har arret på sjælen resten af mit liv. Det var svært for mig at kapere. Det må jeg sgu indrømme.
Clearly, but what you've told us at least convinces me that it created a generation with a hope, those 20 years?
Yes. It helped me and so many women. Today I'm sitting here and I'm having my voice
It's because it was worth it. It meant something. Your fight meant something, and we have got the voice. And today I'm not even standing just for the women of Afghanistan. I'm standing for inclusion, inequality, not only for the women of Afghanistan, but I'm traveling around the world using my voice to empower, inspire, and stand for good cause. And that is what like your fight and your time and all the people who have been there helped me and helped so many women and girls. It was worth it, and we are very happy and appreciate that. Of course, the war continues and takes so many lives, and it is sad, but the generations and generation will stand and understand what you have been through, all the sacrifices of your team, you and everybody who have been in the war, and also our fight in the other side for inclusion and empowerment. We have made change together. You are a soldier in that side protecting us. We have been soldier in this side trying to do everything possible to inspire the younger generation. And that's what you have done. Of course, right now the story is different. It is sad when you see what is going on in Afghanistan. It is sad what I see in Afghanistan, all the years of dedication and non-stop work. But I see also hear the voices of women. They are writing, they are standing. The new generation, the generation of 20s. They are 16, 19 years old, and they are standing. And that's what I see the difference we made.
Mm. Ja, det er også det, som Kalita siger, man kan jo aldrig tage visdom og læring for nogen. Og det er jo også det, som jeg siger, at selvfølgelig, da jeg så det i medierne, selvfølgelig skete der noget ind i mig, så skal man reflektere over tingene, så man skal med så mange andre ting, og lige tænke på, hvorfor var det egentlig, og hvad har det gjort i den lange ende. Og det har jeg jo også fundet ud af, at altså, ligesom du fortæller, at det har givet så meget læring og visdom, bare andre steder, jeg har været. Og det er jo det store billede, og det er jo pissehammerende stolt af den dag i dag. Og det ved jeg også godt, altså, skal nok klare det. Det er et godt, stolt folkefærd, det ved jeg. Det er i hvert fald de mennesker, jeg har mødt.
Nu testede vi jo, inden vi gik i gang, om fingrene virkede, og det gjorde de. Hvis nogen af jer har spørgsmål nu, så kom med dem. I må spørge om hvad som helst. Kalita og Philip er kommet for det samme. Har vi en mikrofon, som vi kan det har med det? Så kan vi starte hernede, så vi lige får jeres spørgsmål med. Den unge mand hernede starter.
Yes. Først og fremmest vil jeg godt lige lov til at sige, det er super rørende at høre jeres historie. Jeg kan slet ikke forestille mig, hvordan det er, hvilke personlige konsekvenser det har haft for jer, den her krig. Men lige meget, hvordan man drejer det, så gik det jo ikke, som vi havde planlagt, kan man sige. Kom Vesten til at give det afghanske folk et smagsprøve på noget, som vi ikke rigtig kunne give dem i sidste ende?
Okay, later, you wanna answer that?
Other question?
Because this ended as it is, did we end up actually giving the people of Afghanistan a taste of something we couldn't give them? So in the end, maybe it was worse than not having it?
I think, I don't see this as something like worse. I see it as something great that we have felt. First of all, as I mentioned in my example, that the Taliban took like my generation telling them that you're just animal. That was the name of woman in the country. So they were treated as an animal. Having the understanding, the freedom to feel like I'm human and I have a power and I can do something. Today what I'm doing, it was worth it. The war continues. And this is our responsibility to make sure in each community and in the countries we are living, we do actively participate to make sure our values are protected. Unfortunately, the Afghanistan, the corruption, the government, didn't manage to keep up the things. And in this war, the Afghan people have also their fault in this. The women of Afghanistan, what they are going through, it's also because of our governing bodies of the country who betrayed the women of Afghanistan. So yes, it was worth it to feel the freedom. It was worth it to feel what is it like. And my generation understood the freedom, the humanity, and that's what we are going to tell our children. So the next generation and generations will understand through our stories and with the hope that we are standing back and we'll take the power again.
Jeg kigger efter fingre nu. Og I ved, hvordan jeg gør. Hvis ikke jeg finder nogle fingre, så slår jeg selv ned. Så jeg tænker, det bedste, at der var en der.
As mentioned, you are very strong and very powerful. And how is it felt knowing that you have perhaps formed a hope for other women in your country?
Was
how does it know feeling that you have formed a hope for other people in your country?
I feel proud. I feel so happy. I feel like standing for to be the voice for those women was worth it, and today they have voice. They have a strong voice even under the Taliban. They are trying everything possible to fight back. They know that the power of the voice. And it's not only me. There's so many women and girls, generation, like younger generation of footballers, the second generation I call them. My teammates or the girls who came after me, they're actually standing, they are really protesting against the Taliban. And they are trying everything possible, even trying to skip and standing to make sure that they have the freedom to play again. And that's the most beautiful thing, that they are standing for their right and they have the power. And it feels good for me. It feels really good. It gives me the hope to really fight. And that's my motivation, because I see that there is actually reflection. I see that my work has made the difference, and I am having, even my voice is becoming more powerful. So that is why I'm not using for only women of Afghanistan, but I am using for inclusion, for equality. And I'm telling my story and telling the stories of women of Afghanistan to inspire other women and girls, and also men around the world, how we as an individual can use our power, because as an individual we don't have the power to have a gun or to have a lot of money, but what as an individual, each of us have a power. How can we use the best possible way to be a good human being, but a good citizen to a country, to a nation that we are living, to give back to our society, to our community, and participate actively to do something good for the world, where more people get inspired by us.
Tak for det spørgsmål. Er der flere, der har lyst? Der er en der.
Jeg tænker, hvis nu hvor Taliban har taget over i Afghanistan igen, vil I så være altså imod eller med at sende styrker der til igen, nu hvor at du har hørt før, at det har haft en rimelig stor påvirkning på andet end dig? Så ved jeg ikke, vil det være noget, I vil støtte, eller vil det være sådan noget igen, som at optræne afghanere, der selv kan kæmpe for deres land?
Jamen altså, vi har jo optrænet den afghanske styrke rigtig meget. Jeg tror, der var lidt med noget motivation med, at de ikke rigtig, ikke rigtig kæmpede, da Taliban kom ind. Der var mange ting, der spillede ind der. Jeg vil ikke have noget imod at sende sikkerhedsstyrker derned igen, men det er et meget stort politisk pille, du spørger, snakker til mig om nu, ikke? Jeg tror godt, du vil kunne samle en masse unge, som vil gå ind i Afghanistan med mange af de ting, som Khalida siger, som deres motivation til at skabe et bedre land dernede og få Taliban skubbet ud. Og det tror jeg er det vigtigste. Hvis der er nogen, der har lysten til at skabe noget bedre for en anden befolkning, så skal man sende styrker ind. Det er min holdning. Om jeg personligt vil tage dig ned igen, det er ikke lige nu, nej. Jeg vil tænke på min dreng, tror jeg, den her gang.
Men det jeg godt kan lide ved det spørgsmål, det er, det skærer det jo ind til benet, fordi det tvinger en til at tænke sig om, var det det værd? Vil man gøre det igen?
Ja. Altså, det er jo lidt svært spørgsmål. Jeg vil gøre det igen, fordi altså, jeg føler, at når jeg virkelig sådan kigger ind i mig selv, så har jeg gjort en eller anden forskel, og jeg har i hvert fald prøvet at gøre en forskel, og det kan jeg aldrig nogensinde i mit liv sige på andre områder, at jeg har gjort. Jeg har virkelig prøvet at gøre noget, og det kan jeg tage med mig i graven, og det vil jeg gøre, og så, som det så gik den ene eller den anden vej, så er jeg sgu stolt, at jeg har prøvet at gøre noget.
Ja, der er en her, helt om foran. Kom du ud og løb igen med det.
First, I'd like to say that I have the greatest respect for both of you and the fight that you fought. But I'm wondering, you have given girls in Afghanistan a voice, and you've helped give them the power of education in your fight. But I'm wondering, do you think that this voice that you have given people is strong enough to create a change for the future generations?
It is very difficult to stand with a very much confidence say yes 100%. But from the reflection, from what we have seen, see for example, when Taliban came first time, they took the power, the right from us to have the education to participate actively. But when I got the education, I stood up, I had the voice. And I felt, what is it that as a human being, as a woman, how can I use my power as an individual to fight for others? I understood, because of the education, because of the awareness, because of what I have learned, to use it in a positive way to give back to my community, to give back to my country, to empower and inspire others. And like from the result of my work, when I started with the women's football, it was only four girls, because the country was, the mindset of the people who were left under the regime of Taliban was that women and girls should belong to kitchen. And like 2 months ago or 1.5 months ago, before the second time the Taliban took over, we had 4,000 and something women and girls registered in football, where they were not only playing football, they were having the education, they were participating actively in society, they were representing, because football for us was never been as just for the sake of the game, but it was a tool for activism. The foundation that I built was to stand for our right to be the voice for voiceless. And that's how the generations after me took that. And having like in a very short period of time, that number, it shows that how effective was our voices and our fight. And today, even like so many women and girls outside Afghanistan is standing because we are echoing, that they are echoing our voices and standing for that. And that is where I feel like it was worth it and was very effective because of the changes. And I'm hoping that, I don't know how long the Taliban will stay in our country. And they have this story, and they have understood to tell the story of freedom, the story of empowerment to their daughters. So their daughters know that, okay, we are not animals. We are not someone that we just belong to kitchen and do the service. But there is something else that my mom kept telling me, because that is how my grandmom kept telling me that before the Taliban, the world was very different. We had the right to have education. We had the right. So that is how I had in back of my mind that how the freedom and the power means. And they will have the stories to tell. And I'm hoping that their mothers will inspire their daughters.
Ja, det er gode spørgsmål. De er næsten lige så kloge, Carsten, som du har fortalt os, de vil være. Carsten har snakket helt om. Er der en hånd der, så skal Mette ud og løbe igen.
Jeg tager den på engelsk, jeg er ikke så god til det. Nej, jeg tager den på dansk, jeg er ikke så god til engelsk.
Okay, det er den vej rundt alligevel, okay.
Det er et spørgsmål til begge to. Tror I selv, Afghanistan kan få talibanerne af magten, eller tror I, vi er nødt til at sætte troppet tilbage til Afghanistan, og vil det så tage lige så lang tid, som det har gjort den sidste gang?
Jeg kan starte. Så jeg tror, at det vil komme til at tage lang tid. Ligesom Khalida siger, så er det jo generationer og generationer, der skal tales ind i det her. Det er håb, optimisme, og så er det viljestyrke, der skal få det her til at vende, og det virker som om, der er mange flere, der har fået en stemme, end før det kom frem. Jeg håber, at... Jeg tror, det kommer til at tage tid, men på et tidspunkt, så er jeg så optimistisk, at jeg tror, at Taliban ikke vil have magt mere.
I think Taliban cannot have the power for longer, for many reasons. First of all, the people of the country, especially the new generation, will stand and really fight back, and they are doing already. The other thing is that the economic pressure from the Western world, they need the money. And the economic pressure on Taliban will make things different. That is what I'm hopeful for, because they cannot continue this power for long without money. And also people of Afghanistan will stand back. They need to be included. They need to have salaries, they need to have education, and that's what they are fighting for. And it is now the power from both sides, the people of Afghanistan, but also the power that from the outside that they are pushing. We will not recognize you as a country or as a regime or as a governing bodies if you don't include women and girls. We will not recognize you as a country if you don't do these things. So that's the pressure that is putting on in Taliban, and now it's them to decide how they will continue, because they have to. There is no way for them to continue like this for a long time. They will collapse.
Du skal ikke være generet. Man går i skole for at lære. Nu har du lært noget. Der er et spørgsmål nede i hjørnet. Ja.
Tak for det.
Was it hard not to give up, you know, when Taliban came and took over again? Because I think you find inspiration in the people, right? But don't you sometimes think, how long can I do this?
It is so obvious when just as individual human being, you feel so much pressure. You feel like, okay, it's the right time to give up. Many times I had the thought. But the thing that I don't like is the giving up. I don't give up. I don't like to give up. And especially on people. I remember first time that I was forced to not play football, and they took the ball from me and told me that you belong to kitchen and should not play. And I was like, okay, I will take this ball and show you and make a history and bring this, the football, the women's football in our culture. Because I have two ways. One, go home, cry. And the other thing is like stand for my right and for the others and make difference. Sometimes it's worth to take those fights. And the fights that I took, it was worth it. It was worth it. Although it took so much from me. I had to leave my family behind. There was so many times that I was attacked. I was harassed. My life was in a great danger. But it was all worth it because of it was not only for me. And I didn't want the culture of seeing women in the kitchen or outside of the society of being seeing women vanish by but just ideology that they don't see women as being part of the country. I knew that I'm making a change. And as an individual, I had that power, and that power was my voice. And I knew that taking all these battles in my life, it has consequences in so many levels for me. I will give many sacrifices in my life
But it was all worth it because it was not only for me, but so many women and girls, also for my country. Sometimes good causes cost, and that was the cost I paid as an individual level, also in so many levels, was worth it. It was worth it when I see women and girls telling me, especially the new generation, that how they felt and how they feel like when they play football. It's beautiful to hear that. And it gives me good motivation that, yeah, whatever we did was worth it.
Så er vi nede foran igen.
Jeg bliver simpelthen nødt til lige at følge op på et spørgsmål, som der var lige før. Fordi jeg har hørt meget af den offentlige debat, at der bruges den undskyldning, at demokrati skal komme indenfra, og befolkningen selv skal ville demokratiet. Og det bygger ligesom lidt videre til det spørgsmål, jeg gerne vil stille jer begge to faktisk. Er det en forudsætning for, at et demokrati skal opstå, at befolkningen selv vil demokratiet, og i så fald vil demokrat eller afghanerne ikke demokratiet?
Ja, nu blev det meget samfundsfagsagtigt, det der. Jeg stod helt af. Noget med demokrati indenfra og sådan noget. Jeg tror simpelthen ikke, jeg kan svare på det der spørgsmål. Men det var fedt. Jeg tror, at Kalita, hun svarer på det. Det var meget velformuleret, meget ud for min liga.
Så fik vi endelig dig, Philip, ikke?
Jo. Ja.
Kalita, you have a go with this one?
I think that democracy is something that comes from people. It is, democracy means the right to, equal right to have education, equal right to have equal participation in society. The right to have your voice, the right to have the voice for yourself, but also for others. And that's democracy. That is the democracy we, the democracy of choices, or the decision, or the choice, the freedom of choices. That is what every individual wants. And our people, especially the younger generation, they felt that, especially the last few years before the Taliban took over. And that is the democracy that they are fighting, they are standing for. And yes, we need also the people from outside to stand for us and fight for us. It's not just because of people of Afghanistan, but for the world. Everyone in the world have the right to have education, to practice the basic human right. Why someone's basic human right, which is access to education, to sports, or even having their voices, should be difficult? Why it should have a cost? And that is actually coming to back to the younger generation. What is happening in the world? We have a voice to take action. That it doesn't mean that we need to go on a war, but it's how we are using our voices to stand against the wrong decisions sometimes by the leaders. Say, what is happening in the world? Your decisions making impact in the world, around the world, for our generation. And our generation don't want to witness something in the world which is wrong. And that is fight for democracy. And it comes from Afghanistan, goes around the world and come back to Afghanistan. And so many other parts around the world.
I think the question was also, how come some people in Afghanistan do not support democracy? Because there are some that are not fighting against the Taliban.
Yeah. The thing is that, as I said, the people, they were part of the people who are brainwashed, and that's called Taliban, Al-Qaeda, and ISIS. Like, one story is that I remember when I was in a refugee center in Pakistan, so many families, they had money, 10 kids and 5 kids, where they were not able to feed them. And there were different schools, that they, the boarding schools that they were taking their kids just for free. And the families wanted to get rid of the kids because of the hunger, because they were not able to
to provide food. And those schools were taking the kids in a very young age and educating what they wanted them to understand. The reason we have Taliban in our country and they are doing everything possible and they're fighting against so-called, like, they are fighting against democracy, that's what they are saying. In reality, they were taught that this world is not for you. The world starts when you die. And that will, when you die, it will be a paradise where you will have the free access to women, free access to food, and you will have the better life. And you will have the access to all the choices. So this world is not yours. This is how they are brainwashed. And that's why they are standing against that, because they have a motivation and they don't know what is actually life mean right now. So that's why they are fighting against, and they are not fighting against democracy, but they are fighting against what they are fighting for, their motivation, objective to go in a haven and have access to a lot of women.
Are we here? Det er tæt på denne gang.
Altså det er for at bygge sammen med rømmer. Så jeg vil ikke sige, at det vil være næsten umuligt, eller tæt på i hvert fald, nogensinde at kunne fuldkommen arbejde sammen med løsning, og måske også imod demokrati, hvis det er det, man føler, det rigtigt. Når vi har den her store holdningsbaserede splittelse om, hvad der er rigtigt og forkert, men måske også den her religiøse splittelse mellem befolkningen.
Philip, havde du et indtryk af, når du var dernede, om den her, oplever man den her splittelse?
Altså, det gør man. Altså, det sted, jeg var, det var meget Taliban-overtaget. Så det, jeg oplevede, det var, som Khalida siger, altså, det var kvindeundertrykkelse på fuld skrue. Det var kvinderne, der var gemt væk i compounds, og så skulle de bare passe børnene hele dagen. Det var de civile, som arbejdede meget sammen med Taliban, for at få os ud, fordi de havde en anden ideologi om, hvad vi kom ind med. Så vi var helt dernede, hvor vi faktisk skulle lave det arbejde, der hedder Hearts and Minds. Fortæl dem, hvorfor vi var her for deres sikkerhed. Men det er det svært at være tro på, fordi de har fået fortalt noget helt andet. Det er fortalt, vi kom ind for at slå dem ihjel og tage deres kvinder og uddanne deres kvinder. Fordi de havde en idé om, den måde, de har lært at leve på, det er den måde, der er den rigtige. Det er deres måde, men der er bare meget undertrykkelse. Og det er jo noget læring, og det er jo læring, der skal starte indenfra og så komme ud af, men det tager jo lang tid. Jeg oplevede et helt andet Afghanistan. Jeg oplevede meget det, som Khalida måske flygtede fra på et tidspunkt. Det var det, der var ude for Kabul. Det var meget stenalder samfund, kan man næsten sige.
I think nothing is impossible. I know that there's complexity is there. It's the religion, it's the culture, it's the ethnical division. There is language difference, and there is of course a group fighting against democracy. But it happened in 2001. It was possible. It was possible that we made the change, we made the difference, and it's possible again. Even though still the complexity was there, the belief and the religion, the fights were still there, but it was possible. So it is even more possible at this time where people, the world developed, and people have access to technology, and still, like, the younger generation have access to a lot of information. They understand and they see the world differently. So this fight for the religion will not continue longer because the new generation think differently. So it is possible, and I see, I'm hopeful and optimistic. Still, even though it's very complex, it's difficult, but I don't say it's impossible. It is possible and will happen, hopefully soon.
Vi nærmer os der, hvor vi snart skal lade nogle andre lærere gøre jer klogere på nogle andre ting. Er der nogen, der har et sidste spørgsmål, eller skal vi... Der var en dernede, det bliver så den sidste for i dag. Så Philip.
Det var lidt højt.
One of the earlier questions was about Taliban and stuff like that. I was wondering, what is to stop some other power-hungry men or politicians from just seizing the power if the Taliban is dethroned from power? I was thinking, like, politicians have this tendency to just promise stuff that they can't keep. So I was like imagining some politician just telling people to get to have freedom if they vote for him, and then not giving it. I imagine that might be as, you know, a problem.
Oh, the question was, it was many questions, sorry.
The question is just, do you think that that it's a reality that you will get freedom if the if Taliban is dethroned, that there isn't just some other power-hungry people gonna seize the power?
I think the situation change if it's Taliban, whoever comes, if they just give the access to education, to basic human right to people. If it's Taliban or any other government come, what people of Afghanistan, I think, want is that their basic human right. They want to have education, they want to have access to freedom, they want to practice democracy. And that is freedom of choices, freedom of having their voices. And right now, Taliban is really fighting hard, and they don't recognize any government. And they have, even though difficult time to stand and say, this is our government. They are fighting right now really hard. They are just separated. They're really fighting against each other. And we have no government yet. And they have no leader yet to announce that this is our leader, and we are Taliban, we are government. So seeing that, it will create a big division in the country, because our country is quite complex, because we have so many tribes and different five ethnical backgrounds, from people who come from different five ethnic backgrounds, where it's different language, looks different, and. And it's right now they are fighting against each other. So what I see is happening, and what also the governments failed in the past, is that they are forcing a central government, which is not working in our country. And what the different tribes want is separation. And I think the separation will happen, and it will be very difficult to have a one central government leading Afghanistan. It will become like another countries. But I'm not I don't have so much knowledge in terms of the politics and a lot of these things. But I'm just very much talking about social side of the things. It's very difficult to answer like with a lot of knowledge about the political aspects of things.
Jeg har hørt mange af jer, nogle af jer i hvert fald lige nævne, at de synes, at Khalida er en inspiration. Og I jo måske også har lidt respekt for, hvor meget hun har kæmpet. Det gør hun stadig. Det bliver hun ved med, så godt kender jeg hende. Hvis nogen af jer er nysgerrige, så følg hende på sociale medier. Der er i hvert fald Twitter, du er meget aktiv, Khalida, og fortæller meget om, hvad du kæmper for, hvor du er henne og hvad du laver. Så gør det. Philip tror jeg slet ikke kan have flere følgere. Jeg tror, du har gennemført det der sociale medie internet der.
Følg mig alligevel.
På søndag, det er på søndag, er det ikke? Klokken 1. Er der fodbold? Grunden til, at jeg nævner det, er fordi, at det er der, hvor Superliga næste spillerunde markerer veteranernes dag. Hvor man har fokus på at hjælpe krigsveteranerne, der kommer hjem. Få dem i arbejde, få dem resocialiseret. Det hedder det. Er det ikke det, Philip?
Det lyder sådan. Ja.
Rehabiliteret, men det der, tror jeg.
Er rehabiliteret, kan ja. Det, ja. Det er der, hvor vi lancerer den kampagne. Det gør vi selvfølgelig også i Farm. Hvis I har lyst til at være med til det, fordi I har brugt jeres tid sammen med os nu, så ved jeg, at man gennem Carsten vil kunne få nogle billetter, hvis det er. Det skal vi nok sørge for, hvis I har lyst til at komme her og fejre det med os. Jeg har sagt, at der ikke er flere spørgsmål. Du er fræk alligevel. Får I på falderæbet.
Jeg vil bare lige spørge, for lige at følge op på det der spørgsmål, om det var det værd. Så blev der allerede spurgt, om det var det værd i forhold til, at nu hvor man har givet de her et falsk håb, og så svarer de så, ja, at det mente de. Så vil jeg så vente om at sige, om det var det værd i forhold til, at mange så måske ville kunne føle sig forrådt og opgivet af Vesten, og så måske kan det resultere i, at mange får sådan ligesom et had til den vestlige verden og os andre, fordi de føler sig forrådt og opgivet af resten af verden.
Det er godt, vi fik den med. Det er et godt spørgsmål.
Den der kan lide den der, tror jeg.
Philip thinks you should answer that, Kalita.
Get him.
Well, it is difficult right now where our people are in the situation. Everybody is shocked. The Taliban came and took over the country, and the government of Afghanistan surrendered like this. We lost the country overnight. It is shocking, and it shocked our people inside Afghanistan. Everybody is surprised still. We are very emotional. The people of Afghanistan, especially the women of Afghanistan, are very, very emotional, and everybody is sad. As well as I hear also from our Western friends that they are sad what is happening, they are witnessing. Yes, the women of Afghanistan feel betrayed. They feel betrayed by, the first feel betrayed by the man of Afghanistan, by the government of Afghanistan, who didn't really work hard, and they were very much focused on corruption and stealing money, that they didn't take the leadership to build a strong foundation with the support that we receive from the Western world. Yes, the women of Afghanistan, the girls of Afghanistan feel left alone. But that doesn't mean that we don't see and recognize all the long time war, and especially support from our Western friends that who dedicated their life to support and protect us. It is very, the situation is very challenging. It's very difficult. It is so much emotional. It's so emotional to even think about it, what's happening, who should we blame. But as a woman of Afghanistan, I blame the man of the country, the government of Afghanistan. All this time, the leaders of Afghanistan failed us. And I don't want to get out of the home to blame our neighbors when our own home didn't support us, didn't make sure that the foundation is strong. And there is also the politicians who also made a lot of decisions in so many levels. In general, we are thankful for all the people, for all the men and women who came in our country, who fought for us, who didn't give up on us. And that includes our friend here and all his friends. And that's why we are thankful and we are happy that we have got the voice. And that is the most important thing.
Tak, Philip, for at dele. Tak, Kalita, fordi du også delte. Og tak til jer, fordi vi måtte komme. Det har været en stor fornøjelse. Tak for jeres tid.
Thank you.
Jeg har også lyst til... Ja, jeg har også lyst til på skolens vegne at sige tusind tak. Tak for jeres ærlighed. Jeg tænker, det er svært at være ærlig på den måde. Det viser en sårbarhed. Men jeg tænker også, den form for ærlighed jo også viser os, at bag alle de her store politiske spørgsmål, og bag noget af den teori, som I også skal arbejde med i samfundsfag omkring international politik og Danmarks rolle, Det er ikke bare teori. Der er faktisk nogle mennesker bagved, for hvem det har betydning, hvad det er for nogle beslutninger, der bliver truffet. Og der tænker jeg, at det, I har gjort, den måde, I har grebet det an på, har på en eller anden måde været med til at lave en forbindelse mellem rigtige mennesker, og så den, det, I arbejder med teoretisk i samfundsfag også. Og jeg håber, at I vil tage det med jer, og også være opmærksom på det her med, at der er faktisk noget, der er værd at kæmpe for. Og I har en platform at kæmpe ud fra. I har jeres ytringsfrihed. I har jeres ret til at mene, hvad I vil. Og I har også en mulighed for at kæmpe for andre end jer selv. Så jeg har det sådan, at det her har været et helt enestående foredrag, en enestående formiddag, hvor jeg synes, at det, der virkelig betyder noget for os som mennesker, er kommet meget, meget tættere på en måde, som også rører os. Og jeg håber, I tager det med derud og bruger alle de muligheder, I har i jeres hverdag, til at kæmpe for det, der er værd at kæmpe for. I har muligheden for det. Og det har I været med til at inspirere til. Tusind tak.
Okay. Ja. Thank you. It doesn't work.